Contour Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Reconnecting with Your Estranged Adult Child, Practical Tips and Tools to Heal Your Relationship, by Tina Gilbertson, narrated by Coleen Marlo. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. A Warning: Listeners whose childhoods involve severe or numerous adverse experiences may find parts of this book disturbing. Some of the discussion, particularly but not exclusively in Chapter 2, could trigger unwanted memories and thoughts, nightmares, or emotional distress. Please seek the support of a qualified mental health professional if you find yourself experiencing any of these symptoms while listening to this book. Disclaimers: The material in this book is intended for education. It is not meant to take the place of diagnosis and treatment by a qualified medical practitioner or therapist. No expressed or implied guarantee of the effects of the use of the recommendations can be given or liability taken. None of the characters mentioned in this book are real people. Rather, they are composites drawn from many different stories of estrangement. All the names are fictitious, and any resemblance to specific individuals is coincidental. In contrast, all quoted comments were submitted by real people, who remain anonymous even to the author. When it comes to relationships and what it takes to repair them, one size doesn't fit all. Instead of offering a step-by-step blueprint for every parent to follow to success, this book provides a collection of ideas, factual information, expert opinion, and tools that readers may choose to employ in approaching their unique circumstances. In the context of your personal situation, some of the recommendations may not be appropriate. Please use your own judgment or seek counsel before implementing any advice you hear in this book. Introduction. Do you love your child or children? Do you want them to be happy? Have you done your best to parent them well? If you're listening to this book, I bet you'll answer a definite yes to all three questions. From the time their children are born, most parents focus considerable energy on giving them everything they need to succeed in life. New mothers and fathers look forward to watching their kids grow up and find partners, and they picture themselves holding grandchildren in their arms. They bask in the anticipation of watching their descendants continue family traditions. These dreams of the future make all the sacrifices inherent in being a parent worthwhile. But in many modern families, the parent-child relationship goes sour when the children become adults. A divide opens up between the apple and the tree that bore it. As the distance grows, mom or dad's vision of a happy multi-generational family starts to fade. Many parents today feel the sting of this type of estrangement. The word estrangement comes from the Latin word extenere, meaning to treat as a stranger. Becoming a stranger to one's child is one of the most painful things that can happen to a parent. If you're reeling from the shock and pain of having an estranged adult child, this book is for you. Let me add a couple of caveats. Things to know before we go. First, if your child appears to be lost in any kind of addiction, it's important to understand that addiction is a serious medical problem requiring intervention beyond the scope of this book. People with active addictions aren't emotionally available to participate in relationships. No matter how well you implement the guidelines in this or any other book about relationships, you may not be able to get through to someone whose primary connection is to a substance or process. If this is the case with your child, please read as much as you can about addiction and seek help through your local social services. Also, team up with other people in your child's life. Her addiction will affect all her relationships, not just those with family. Second, this book assumes you have a growth mindset, that you're interested in becoming the best possible version of yourself. You're not likely to find answers in these chapters if you're convinced the only positive outcome is for your child to suddenly change his mind and contact you, or to spontaneously forgive anything that needs forgiving. Those things can happen, but reunions based on spontaneous forgiveness are usually temporary, since the black box containing the causes of the estrangement remains unopened. This book invites you to make changes in the way you think, feel, and behave. If reconciliation is to occur, let alone become permanent, it will most likely begin with you. If you had custody of and a close relationship with your child at any time before she became an adult, and someone seems to be turning her against you now, there's much you can do to rebuild your relationship. If your child has a spouse or partner, you might end up with two relationships for the price of one. And in general, your family may not look the way you once envisioned it. But if you value family as I do, that won't matter in the end. If your estranged child is under the age of 30 or has recently left home, he may simply be undergoing a normal phase of adult development that calls for more psychological distance from parents. It's a stage that can be alarming for both parents and children, but it doesn't last forever. If you're the parent of a young adult, Chapter 5 is just for you. You may also benefit from other parts of the book, especially those concerning self-care and personal development. You might need to wait a while before putting into practice some of the other ideas presented here with your adult son or daughter. Throughout the book, I assumed that both parents and adult children would prefer a loving, harmonious, and fulfilling relationship, and that such a relationship is possible with time, knowledge, and effort. But you don't have to work actively toward reconciliation to benefit from this book. Although you enter estrangement in pieces, it's a crucible that can make you whole again, not just as someone's parent, but for yourself. There's no quick fix to be found in this book, or any book. Estrangement doesn't happen overnight, and it won't be healed that quickly either. Although this is a manual for repairing your relationship with your child and creating lasting change, that undertaking will require consistent effort over time. The matured tree of your relationship has been decades in the making. It won't bend as easily as a sapling would. It will take time for you to rework your connection into something new and better. I hope to provide you with tools to do just that. Time is limited. It can't be paused or slowed, and it keeps stealing days from you and your child. Sadly, there's no remedy for that. All you can do is to use wisely the weeks, months, or years you spend apart. When you have confidence that the steps you're taking now are adding to the relationship and will help move it in the right direction, you can settle into the work of healing the relationship from within. With all its tasks and challenges that force you to grow, the work will be worthwhile no matter what the outcome. A new foundation poured over an old crumbling one is not stable. Any fissures in the bond between you and your child must be carefully sealed before the next foundation can be safely poured. I wrote this book largely to illuminate as many cracks and holes as possible, and to suggest ways to repair them. Once you seal the gaps, you'll be in a far better position to create a secure base for a closer relationship. You won't identify with every statement or idea in this book. We're all different, and your family situation is unique. Estrangement itself constitutes far too broad and complex a topic for every circumstances to be covered here. What you take from this book and what you leave is up to you. If something doesn't speak to your situation, or if a piece of advice just doesn't feel right, trust your own judgment. But if you're interested in personal growth, as well as reconnection with your child, I hope you'll find something here that resonates with you and supports you in that endeavor. It will be most effective for you to listen to this book from the beginning rather than skipping around. Each concept builds on the previous ones. If you skip around looking for sections that interest you, you won't necessarily have a firm base from which to make the best use of the practical steps outlined. I suggest that you listen to the entire book before taking any action, then listen to it again for support while executing your strategy. About me. As a psychotherapist in private practice for more than a decade, I've heard from both angry, frustrated, depressed adult children and bewildered, hurting, rejected parents about their distressed relationships. The information I use in my approach to helping parents repair these bonds includes the actual experiences of people in your shoes. Although what works and what doesn't are not categorical, certain general truths can be mined and used in tackling the problem. I've never been either an estranged adult child or a rejected parent. I have, as they say, no dog in this fight. As a stepmother, daughter, wife, and sister who is deeply attached to my own family, I have tremendous compassion for anyone estranged from someone they love. Because I haven't been subjected to this hurtful breach myself, I'm free of the bias that inevitably arises from firsthand experience. based on a thorough review of current research and my own experience listening to the stories of hundreds of suffering parents and estranged adult children. I can take the proverbial view from 30,000 feet. Anyone thus removed from the fray can discern patterns that exist outside their own individual story. Free from the wounds and protective instincts born of painful experience, I help parents trace lines of opportunity for healing and repair. I have no agenda other than to help as many people as I can who are suffering the loss of relationship with loved ones. There's a lot that's broken among modern families, and much of it can be mended. Not all, unfortunately, but more than you might think. I know because I hear regularly from parents in the Reconnection Club, my online community for estranged parents, at reconnectionclub.com, who have managed to make repairs and turn things around with the benefit of an outside perspective and some heartfelt support. I fell into this rewarding line of work quite by accident. During my internship and graduate school, I was surprised at how many of my adult clients avoided or dreaded contact with their parents. When I asked them to describe the issues that troubled them, it became clear that their parents either wouldn't or couldn't fathom their children's experience. I remember thinking, those parents might appreciate hearing a translation from a neutral observer. So when I built a website for my therapy practice in 2008, I posted a couple of articles designed to help parents reconnect with reluctant adult children. Like many other writers on this topic, I was overwhelmed by the immediate outpouring of communication from estranged parents. Every article I wrote seemed to generate scores of comments and questions. Clearly, this painful problem deserved a thoughtful and much more extensive response. I wrote, My Guide for Parents of Estranged Adult Children, a document of just over 100 pages, to try to address parents' need for assistance. The guide sold in PDF form on my website for a number of years as part of an email-based program of support for parents. Eventually, as the sheer volume of feedback from parents convinced me that the guide should serve a wider audience, I decided to expand it into a book. This is the result. I believe in the importance, influence, and value of family. My own kin have shaped me into the person I am, and each member of my small clan is precious to me. When I think of what it would feel like to lose connection with them, the pain is almost physical. My familiarity with the hearts and minds of adults who reject their parents, and my conversations with parents who have managed to repair the rifts, along with my training in psychology and human development, have given me insights into the problem of parent-adult-child estrangement. I want to share some secrets with you so that you have the most powerful tools, and possibly new skills, with which to approach the all-important relationship with your child, children. I have faith that rifts between family members can be healed if just one person has the fortitude to venture outside their comfort zone. My money's on you, the one who picked this book. With courage, change is possible even when it seems like there's no reason for hope. It's never too late for things to get better. Estrangement changes everything. That question, "Do you have children?" was so easy at one time. "Yes, I have two." Or, "Yes, a little girl," was your automatic answer. But it's not that simple anymore. Now you've got an adult child who's not talking to you, and you're not sure what to say when asked about children. You may not even know where he lives. You may have a grandchild you've never met. How do you answer those painful questions? I'll offer specific ideas about that in Chapter 9. And what do you do with the emotions that are constantly triggered? There may be grief and despair, yes, but there might also be resentment and anger. You gave so much of yourself, time, love, money, energy, to your child. How can he repay you by acting this way? You're listening to this book because you want your relationship with your child back, but you also want to emerge from this ordeal without the shadow of all that pain. How will you heal the deep wounds surrounding this rejection? Those hurt feelings need to be resolved, no matter what happens in the future. If you've listened this far, you're likely ready and willing to do some self-reflection. You know what will benefit your personal growth, even if your adult child never comes around, though I hope for both your sakes that's not the case. A bit of navel-gazing is valuable for someone in your shoes, not to punish yourself for mistakes made in parenting, but rather to uncover and get to know your essential, lovable self. This core part of you can lose vitality when you're being held at arm's length by someone you love. Although you know you're not perfect, you're probably ready to let go of any unnecessary shame that's been weighing you down, maybe starting before the estrangement began. I assume you want to enjoy a healthy level of self-esteem and to maintain good communication with the people most important to you. I believe you also want to be a positive role model, even if only for yourself, and a self-actualized, reasonably content and fulfilled human being. Change is possible, both within and without. The greatest burden for estranged parents is unnecessary shame. My purpose is not just to help you repair your relationship with your child, but also to fortify your bond with yourself. Healing from estrangement is an opportunity for intense personal growth if you're up for it. This is true whatever the outcome may be. No one wants this. In online forums for rejected parents, younger people are often portrayed as a generation of narcissists ready to kick their parents to the curb at the slightest provocation. Some parents who write about estrangement, especially on the internet, encourage you to view your child as heartless, selfish, materialistic, or easily brainwashed by malevolent others. But if that's the case, how can there be any hope for reconciliation? And why would you even want to reunite with someone like that? Let's get some perspective. For thousands of years, older adults have lamented the selfishness, lack of discipline, and sense of duty, not to mention the shameful disrespect, of the younger generation. In his book, The Vanishing American Adult, U.S. Senator Ben Sasse argues that for at least the past 50 years, age segregation, lack of exposure to hard work, overprotectiveness by parents, and material abundance have created generations of perpetual children, complete with childish sensibilities. If this is true, where does that leave you? It's too late to go back and try to build your child's character, reduce her selfishness, or help her develop a will towards service, compassion, and respect. The only value now in focusing on your child's or an entire generation's lack of character is to take a break from blaming yourself for the current state of your relationship. That's a break that might be necessary if you've been beating yourself up over it. But on the other side of that break, you want to seek solutions that don't denigrate you or your child. No degree of entitlement, materialism, or lack of work ethic can strip an otherwise normal person of their emotional attachments. Even if your child is excessively entitled or immature, those deficits in themselves don't explain why he feels the need to reject his parents or other family members. The reasons for this behavior go beyond the limitations of his generation or personality. Believing this is the only stance that allows for solution-focused thinking about this pernicious predicament. Both in my capacity as a therapist and as a regular citizen, I've talked with adults who are struggling with the decision to cut ties with their parents, have already done so, or have recently reconciled with a formerly rejected parent. I've also followed the research that studies the feelings and motivations of these adult children. By all accounts, these folks take parental estrangement seriously. They feel weighed down by it. It hurts them profoundly to lose connection with a parent, even by their own choice. Here's what one estranged child wrote in response to one of my posts. It is awful when you choose to end a relationship, especially when your parent doesn't, maybe even can't, understand what they did wrong. To turn away from them in order to move forward as a healthier person feels absolutely selfish and goes against my instincts to maintain that connection with my mother. I've heard similar expressions of dismay from my clients, friends, and colleagues who reluctantly avoid their parents. Everyone wants to have parents they love and to love them back without chronic trouble or pain between them. It cuts both ways. Most parents don't get to see the vulnerability and unhappiness in their distancing child. Instead, they're presented only with heated rejection or chilly indifference. No wonder they're sometimes ready to believe they created a monster. We humans are at our most hurtful to others, our most monstrous, when we're in pain ourselves. As the saying goes, hurt people hurt people. It makes sense that your child's rejection, coming as it does from a place of pain, would also be hurtful to you. Birthdays and holidays produce hotspots of difficult emotions for rejected parents. Even the anticipation of a holiday can elicit dread and despair. But what of the adult child? For every Thanksgiving dinner you endure without your child, watching others gather with their families, she also experiences the holiday without you. You and your estranged child also share the task of explaining to friends why you won't be getting together with the family for the holidays this year. Believe it or not, it's the same awkward conversation for him that it is for you. Estranged adult children, for the most part, feel unsupported when they share the sensitive information that they're estranged from you. Friends, relatives, and society all pressure them to reconcile. It's clear that the vast majority of estrangers do not cut ties with their parents on a whim, for purely materialistic reasons, or just because someone else tells them to. So, please don't let me lose you here. Contact with mom or dad has to be pretty darn painful to be worse than no contact. Don't worry, it's not necessarily as bad as it sounds, and the situation can potentially be mended if you keep an open mind. Let me share some encouraging words from mom who's now reconnected with her formerly estranged daughter. I didn't know what to do and couldn't work out why my daughter was so angry and hostile towards me and didn't initiate any contact. I can now appreciate how complex the situation was and feel able to look at our estrangement more from her perspective. You and your estranged child are both in uncharted waters. He may not have the words to tell you what went wrong or what he'd like you to do about it. Even if he does, he might use language or examples that only confuse you and leave you feeling helpless. That's why I'm going to give you plenty of ideas to find your way back to him. Keep a beginner's mind and a compassionate heart as we go forward. You'll need these to make use of the tools offered in these chapters. It's a hard truth, but important to understand. For many adult children and their advocates, estrangement is considered a healthy response to an unhealthy situation. They feel better with distance, healthier, and even happier from day to day. I can't stress enough that no one should be forced, coerced, or shamed into participating in relationships that hurt them, either emotionally or physically, even with family. Trying to influence your child in these ways will do more harm than good. Your child probably views you, your behavior, and your relationship with her as unalterably unsatisfying in some way. It's been easier for her to give up on you than to hope you're willing and able to change. This is what you're up against. If you now want to help her heal and be a part of her life again, you've got to convince your child that a relationship with you can be low in stress and high in fulfillment. It's not easy, but there are specific behaviors you can adopt or increase to help make it happen. I'll provide you with multiple ideas to incorporate into your reconciliation strategy. The problem of shame. Healing the rift of estrangement is possible, but shame, guilt, and anger can make the work much harder for parents than it needs to be. Just about any parent, estranged from their kids or not, harbors some degree of shame, regret, or feeling of inadequacy. Some parents hide it better than others, but if you're in touch with reality, you know how easy it is to go wrong when rearing another human being. It's almost impossible not to feel inadequate in the face of such a monumental challenge. Nobody gets it 100% right, not even close, and shame is the unfortunate byproduct of caring how you're doing. Being concerned about what kind of parent you've been is part of being a good person. Only good people feel bad when they think they might have done something wrong or unwittingly hurt someone. Bad people don't care. Probably that's what makes them bad people. Personally, I've never met a bad person in my work with estranged parents, but I have met hundreds of good people who have shame, whether they're in conscious touch with it or not, about not being good enough, and that shame impedes their ability to turn things around. If this is resonating with you, take your time going over the section on self-esteem in Chapter 12. Luck of the draw. You might think that the more abusive, neglectful, or incompetent the parents, the more likely they are to be cut off the minute their children are old enough to leave. The myth that estrangement springs from only the worst possible parenting is a common misconception that keeps rejected parents up at night. In my experience, parent-adult-child estrangement doesn't occur in lockstep with terrible parenting. Some of the most abusive, neglectful, seemingly incompetent parents enjoy doting behavior from their grown children. Conversely, parents who are conscientious and tried their hardest to give their kids everything they needed can find themselves on the outs with their kids when they grow up. Estrangement from an adult child can happen to any parent, regardless of how dedicated they were, how much they sacrificed, or how hard they tried to do better than their own parents did with them. There are innumerable factors that contribute, and from what I've seen, luck seems to be one of them. It's easy to forget this when you feel ashamed about being rejected, but shame makes the situation stickier. When you don't feel good enough, that conviction is all-consuming. You can't afford to look at specific things you might do better, because admitting to even one misstep feels like admitting you're utterly bad. One estranged parent wrote this in response to one of my articles. This helps a little, but I still do not understand why I am so unlovable. Unlovable? Where did that come from? This comment broke my heart when I read it. Estrangement by a child can tap into dark feelings of low self-worth that were probably present before the estrangement began. The rejection feels raw, personal, and almost overwhelming. That's why it's so challenging to take a neutral, curious stance when adult children create distance. If you suffer from shame, you'll find it too painful to think very hard about any wrong turns you may have taken until your child sends you a message of anger or silence that you can't ignore. But wait a minute. Your child's silence may have nothing to do with mistakes you've made. Don't assume you've done anything to invite this rejection if your child hasn't said so. I talk about normal, no-fault estrangement as part of your child's personal development in Chapter 5. Whether or not the estrangement is acrimonious. Many parents become defensive when their adult children don't want to maintain contact. Shame and defensiveness are the enemies of awareness. And unfortunately, there can be no movement, no change, and no healing without awareness. Shame says, I don't want to know if I did anything to deserve this. It's too painful to feel that bad about myself. Awareness says, I want to understand my part in this, even if it's painful. In order to recover a relationship with your child, you must find a way to put shame aside and to invite compassion into your heart. You need to tolerate looking at whatever your child may want to show you if healing is to occur. If there is something important for you to learn about the way your child experiences you, you won't be able to see it through a cloud of shame. You have no option for a considered response as long as shame and defensiveness have you in their grip. Breaking free of these can pave the way for a closer, calmer, and more honest relationship with your child. This is from a reader of one of my blog posts. I had many years of a very painful relationship with my mother. When I was 35, there was a breakthrough. She admitted in a letter that she had loved me, but with white-knuckled love. That moment transformed my life, as I was finally able to know that this deep truth I knew about her love, but could not admit, was true. I became much more able to feel sane. Your will towards self-awareness can not only thaw your relationship with your estranged child, but can also help her understand herself better. Thus, it can be a gift to both of you. Compassion is key. You are a loving, lovable, and still growing version of somebody's child yourself. You may be surprised by the idea that finding compassion in your heart, not just for your child, but for yourself, can help you overcome estrangement. Instead of approaching the problem with a right and wrong mentality, which pits you and your child against each other, compassion says you're in this together. I see far too many comments from hurting parents that look like this. My daughter chose to cut me off after having helped her through lifelong traumas with no appreciation or thankfulness on her part whatsoever. Estrangement between an adult child and a parent is usually the result of this generation's give me, give me, give me attitude, and nothing is ever good enough for these selfish, self-absorbed adult brats. The harsh tone and the name-calling are clear indications of the amount of pain this mother is in. Yet if reconciliation is the ultimate goal, this us-versus-them mentality can't prevail. The writer of this comment appears to be hurting too much at the moment to see that she and her daughter are in this together. She's lost sight of her daughter as another unique, still-growing individual. In this comment, she demonizes her daughter and an entire generation. This is what happens when we feel powerless against those who hurt us. We become frozen in our anguish, and our hearts become hard. This parent's pain needs to be acknowledged so that she can begin to heal from the agony of being rejected. Her daughter is not the right person to help her with that, no matter how close they used to be. But that doesn't mean this mom is out of luck. She can, and must if she wants to heal, receive the compassion she deserves. If there's someone in her life who's understanding and sympathetic, she can cry on that person's shoulder and begin the healing process. She can talk to a friend, counselor, or cleric who will stand as a caring witness to her suffering. Whatever the outcome of the estrangement, her own healing will facilitate positive change. This mom needs no less than to be heard and cared about, not least by herself, in order for the storm to subside and the waves to calm. Once she addresses and responds with genuine sympathy to her own pain, she can better deal with that of her daughter, who has surely also endured pain, if she's willing to cut ties to her one and only mother. Every generation needs and deserves compassion. Parents, children, children who become parents, their children, and so on and so on and so on. We're all in this together. 1. Faces of estrangement. Family estrangement, according to the researcher Kylie Aglias, is the condition of being physically and/or emotionally distanced from one or more family members, either by choice or at the request or decision of the other. But what does that actually look like? Depending on the quality, quantity, and frequency of contact, estrangement can have many different manifestations. You may see your child frequently, but each meeting leaves you feeling empty and depressed because of the emotional distance between you. Or it may be years since you've seen your child or had any word from her at all. You don't know where she lives or whether she's married or has a job, let alone children of her own. It seems to me that estrangement can be roughly divided into three types: total cutoff, emotional estrangement, and on and off estrangement. There are variations on these, and the categories may overlap, but let's discuss each one. Total cutoff. My grandmother left home when she was still a teenager, and she never looked back. Her children, including my mother, never met their grandparents on that side of the family. It was total cutoff, physical and emotional. As far as my mother knows, her mother never spoke to her parents for the rest of her life. It's not known how often estrangement becomes lifelong. When my grandmother left her parents' house in rural Brazil in the late 1920s, there were no private telephones, let alone cell phones, email, internet, or social media. Even if my great-grandparents had wanted to reach out to their daughter, in those days they had no way to look for her after she moved away. With every decade in modern history, it's become harder to disappear, which means it's easier than ever to find someone if you want to try to reconnect. Obviously, finding them is not the only issue. Knowing what to do after you locate your child is the most important way to ensure that estrangement doesn't last forever. Emotional estrangement. Estrangement doesn't always mean cutoff. Some parents feel estranged from their adult children even with regular social contact. The problem is that they begin to feel like strangers or intruders to their kids, rather than close and comfortable as they once did. Their contact lacks real emotional connection. Instead, it feels limited and even strained. Maria and Miguel, not their real names, had three sons. Arturo, the youngest, had a special bond with his mother. As a child, he loved helping her with the shopping and often asked her to sit with him while he finished his homework. Maria was happy to oblige, as it meant spending quality time with her sweet youngest child. As he grew older, Arturo asked Maria for advice about relationships, career, and just about anything that was on his mind. Unlike his friends who had begun emotionally distancing themselves from their mothers as teenagers, Arturo always seemed to appreciate his relationship with Maria. Even after earning a degree in finance, getting a good job, leaving his parents' home, and starting to date seriously, Arturo kept in regular contact with his parents. He and Maria would often meet for lunch, take walks, go to the movies, and chat on the phone. Then Arturo met Eva, and the two quickly married. Maria and Miguel rejoiced for their youngest son. Their family had already expanded with the marriage of one of Arturo's older brothers, and Maria pictured the next few decades filled with joyful family gatherings that included Arturo, Eva, and, who knows, maybe a grandchild or two. But from the beginning, Eva didn't seem interested in spending time with Maria and Miguel. Any event that brought the family together was generally short-lived. Eva would complain of a headache, or she would need to get up early in the morning the next day. There was always a reason why Arturo and Eva couldn't stay longer than an hour or two. Soon, Arturo himself became too busy to meet Maria for lunch or shopping. He would always return her calls, though not necessarily right away, and he would decline invitations more often than not. On the rare occasions when they were alone together, the conversation felt forced. Gone was the natural, wide-ranging, and playful chatter Maria had enjoyed with her son. Arturo refused to listen to Maria's mild complaints about his wife's aloofness. He always defended Eva, even when she did something Maria found hurtful. Maria was shocked at her son's unwillingness to try to facilitate a warmer relationship between his mother and his wife. Why didn't he seem to care if they got along? Something between Maria and Arturo had changed, and even though they were still in touch and lived only a few miles apart, she felt she'd lost him. His dwindling availability and apparent loyalty to someone who appeared to dislike Maria threatened to make the change permanent. It was as though she and her son were destined to become strangers. Emotional estrangement can be every bit as painful as total cutoff, though in a different way. Sometimes the solution to emotional estrangement, if there is one, is to repair a damaged relationship with your child. But sometimes the repair that's required is inside you. Often both may be needed, which is why we'll talk as much about you as we will about your child in later chapters. On again, off again. Somewhere between my grandmother's total cutoff and Maria's there but not there relationship with Arturo lies yet another version of estrangement, the on-again, off-again kind. Aglias refers to this as cyclical estrangement. A few years ago, I received an email from a formerly estranged mother. She was excited to tell me that she and her husband had managed to reconcile with their son, who hadn't spoken to them in over a year. Not only did they reconcile, she said, but apparently the son was planning to move back in with his parents. I know what you're thinking. Is this supposed to be a success story? The son did move back in, and unfortunately, less than a year later, I received a far less happy note from his mother. She reported that although her son still lived under the same roof, he'd once again ceased communicating with his parents. He stays in his room all the time now, this despairing mom told me. He even keeps the cat in there with him. We're not allowed to have contact with a cat. It may be unusual for a complete cutoff to become a roommate situation overnight, as happened in this family. But this pattern of now we're talking, now we're not, is a common form of estrangement between adult children and their parents. Pressure from social networks and the culture at large caused some adult children to reconcile with their parents even when the causes of the estrangement haven't yet been addressed. Personal ambivalence and a desire for connection with family, that is, internal pressures, also draw formerly estranged children back into their parents' lives. However, when the underlying causes of estrangement are not attended to, the off-again part of the cycle is likely to repeat. If this pattern describes your relationship with your child, finding and addressing the difficulty with being close is key. How to tell if you're estranged? There's no diagnostic definition of estrangement. But essentially, if someone isn't talking to you because of a negative relationship, or if communication between you is so difficult or distressing for one or both of you that it's minimized, the two of you are probably estranged. Estrangement can involve an absence of feelings, negative feelings, no contact, low quality contact, for example, conflict, or low frequency contact. Estranged people may see each other regularly, sporadically, or never. They might talk on the phone, only via text or email, or not at all. In my experience, the more of the following statements you agree with in the context of your relationship, the more likely it is that you're estranged. I miss the relationship we used to have. Our contact often doesn't go well. I find myself walking on eggshells around this person. I'm worried about the growing distance between us. This person often misinterprets my intentions. I've felt hurt by this person. When I reach out, I don't get a response. I'm in pain over this relationship. Sometimes I'm afraid to reach out. This person has negative feelings toward me. Affirmative responses to five or more of these statements is a good indication that you're currently estranged. but you probably knew that already. If there's any good news here, it's that you have loads of company. You're not alone. Most parents who consult with me about estrangement from their adult children feel as though they're the only ones with this problem. All their friends seem to enjoy close contact with their children, and so they wonder, what's wrong with us? Statistically, many parents are vulnerable. Estrangement between parents and adult children is widespread and might even be on the rise as family networks shrink and geographical distance grows. A lack of data from before the present century makes it tough to determine whether estrangement is on the rise. But it's estimated that at least 1 in 10 mothers, and possibly even more fathers, are estranged from at least one of their adult children. The definition of an epidemic is any occurrence greater than what would normally be expected. That's it. No numbers, no threshold, just any incidence of a thing that's greater than we expect. Given that we live in a society that expects families to love each other and seek continuing contact for life, any incidence of parent-adult-child estrangement is, by definition, an epidemic. Because of the stigma still associated with this type of estrangement, people are often uncomfortable talking about it. But that doesn't stop them from needing to talk. Rejected and abandoned parents and their troubled adult children turn to the internet in droves, seeking solutions to their pain and an outlet for their thoughts and feelings. Here are some search phrases that brought people to my website one day while I was writing my original guide. My son doesn't communicate with me. Should kids be in parents' will when they don't speak to parents? My adult children have become selfish toward me. Can my estranged father cut me out of his will without signing it? Rejected by adult child. Daughter-in-law won't let us see grandkids. Why do today's adult children not say thank you to their parents? How often should I let my mom see her grandson? These are just from one day. Multiply this list by hundreds, and you'll start to appreciate the scope of the problem. Thousands of such searches take place on the internet every week. If you've sought help for estrangement online, you have company. What the research says so far. Research on estrangement is sparse, but seems to be gathering steam. There's virtually no quantitative information from the 20th century. And it's only in the last decade or two that the topic's been garnering interest. That's why it's impossible to say whether what you're experiencing is on the rise. We just don't have the data. But remember my grandmother? She disappeared from her family's lives almost 100 years ago. If you look back into the roots of your own family tree, you might well find estrangement there, too. Oh, and there are a couple of mentions of parent-child estrangements in the Bible, too. Coming back to the present, here's some of what we've learned from the research so far. Prevalence estimates regarding family estrangement vary widely, from single digits to almost 30%. One study involving college students found that 43% of them reported experiencing a definite estrangement from someone in their family. But a conservative estimate endorsed by the researcher Christina Sharp is 12%. Estrangement from dad may be more prevalent than from mom. Most research subjects in this area have been women, and we know very little about fathers and sons' experiences of estrangement. Like most therapists, I see more women than men in my practice. But the fathers I work with are as wounded by estrangement as any mother I've sat with. In fact, it's been suggested that alienation from their children may even contribute to suicide rates among fathers. It probably won't surprise you that divorce is often a precursor to estrangement. However, in one study, only 2.3% of adult children cited divorce as the primary reason for their estrangement from a parent. Divorce per se doesn't cause estrangement. Instead, it can reveal and aggravate hidden fault lines in families. Depending on the temperature and tone of the divorce, it can intensify existing negative feelings between parents and children. In addition, divorce is usually associated with other relationship stressors such as negative emotion, inadequate communication, relocation, financial restriction, and loss of support. Adult children who report having felt close to a parent during adolescence are less likely to become estranged later on, whereas high conflict with a parent during adolescence is assumed to be a risk factor for estrangement in adulthood. If you had a contentious relationship with your teenager, you've got some work ahead of you that may involve revisiting the past in a purposeful way. I'll talk about how to do that later. Estrangement from parents may be more common among communities that are marginalized or stigmatized, such as the LGBTQ community. It's easy to understand why that would be. Some parents are devastated by their child's revelation of a non-conforming sexuality or gender identity. There might be other issues as well. But accepting your child as he is and communicating that fact clearly and often can heal estrangement based solely on gender or sexual identity. For ideas on how to support your LGBTQ child, contact PFLAG at pflag.org. That's pflag.org. Under the heading, Factors You Never Realized Would Have an Impact, is the following. Having a small family or having strained or non-existent ties with extended family increases estrangement risk. A smaller family network makes it easier to maintain estrangement and may therefore support estranging behavior. You can't double or triple the size of your family overnight to avoid this risk, but you can begin to strengthen any ties you have with extended family. If it doesn't help with your child, it could still be pleasant for you to connect with kin. What do we know about the causes of estrangement? For one thing, parents are more likely to blame external circumstances, such as divorce or third-party interference, than children are. Adult children are far more likely to identify personal negative characteristics of their parents as the causes of estrangement. An online survey found that while around 66% of adult children say they've told their parents the reason for the estrangement, 60% of parents claim their child has not explained the cutoff at all. That disconnect alone explains the ongoing nature of many an estrangement. I suppose it's possible that either adult children or their parents aren't telling the whole truth. However, to me it seems more likely that both are conveying the truth as they see it. If conversations between my husband and me are...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.